I'm going to ask you to turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Acts, if you have your Bibles with you. And I want to talk about an ancient message through modern means to a postmodern world, taking a look at what it is that the Apostle Paul did in communicating an apologetic message and an approach, how it was he was able to hark back to the gospel in this tremendously philosophical mix in which he found himself. There were several cultures, of course, that converged into the consciousness of the people that he was ministering to, and he himself had had some of them coalesce in his own life. The story that we read actually in chapter 24 of the book of Acts is coming right in the middle of a series of challenges. He is at the tail end of his life now. His ministry is coming to an end. And it would be a great exercise for you if you just even turned back a few chapters when you get back to your rooms and see what all has already transpired. Because when we jump into this message, it's like jumping into almost what has the appearance of a fresh encounter. But he came close to being lynched by a mob. He had already stood before the Sanhedrin. He lost his composure for a moment in coming right back at the high priest. And they are after him. They want to do away with him. And Felix has actually waited till they bring their case against him. But those who wanted to rescue him, particularly the centurion, every time he heard Paul, he said there's something very unusual about the way this man defends himself. He laid claim to his Roman citizenship, and the amazing thing was when he spoke to the crowd earlier, the Bible tells us they listened to him very carefully because he connected with them in their own language. They wondered what he was going to say, because someone said to him, "Aren't you a Greek?" He said, "No, I am a Roman citizen." And then when he started to speak to them, it said they became silent when he spoke to them in Aramaic. And obviously he is using the terms and the metaphors and the storyline that causes them to listen very carefully. It was only when he used that one forbidden word in their midst, when he said, "Now God has appointed me a missionary to the Gentiles," that one word triggered the storm, and they wanted at that point to do away with him. And so Paul has this incredible ability to connect with people where they are, but not to shy away from what he ultimately has to say to them. There is a poem that is generally credited to anonymity, and it goes like this. When God wants to drill a man and thrill a man and skill a man, when God wants to mold a man to play the noblest part, when he yearns with all his heart to create so great and bold a man that all the world might be amazed, watch his methods, watch his ways. How he ruthlessly perfects whom he royally elects, how he hammers and hurts him and with mighty blows converts him into trial shapes of clay that only God understands. How he bends but never breaks. How he uses whom he chooses and with mighty acts induces him to try his splendor out. God knows what he's about. And God wants to drill a person, thrill a person, skill a person. Watch his methods, watch his ways. That's how God has worked in history. He generally brings about a design in an individual. And that individual is shaped, and the beautiful threads of the grand weaver come into place. And so when you look at Moses in the Old Testament and Paul in the New, you see the same pattern at work. Just recently I was in Syria, and standing outside the wall looking at it in Damascus, and I couldn't help but think that 2,000 years ago, a man was put into a basket and lowered over that wall. And they did not know who was in their basket. Somebody was going to pen one third of the New Testament for posterity. And I left there and went on to Cairo to have meetings there. And I was staying at one of the hotels, which is right by the River Nile. And I thought 3,500 years ago, there was a baby in a basket placed there. So I phoned my wife that afternoon, couldn't resist it. I said, there's more to be said for basket cases than we might imagine. When God wants to drill a person, thrill a person, skill a person, watch his methods, watch his ways. Now here it is that Felix has already begun the hearing, and you've got all that is going on. The charges have been made by Tertullus and so on, and now Paul begins to make his defense. Reading from verse 22. Then Felix, who was well acquainted with the way, adjourned the proceedings. When Lysias the commander comes, he said, I will decide your case. He ordered the centurion to keep Paul under guard, but to give him some freedom and permit his friends to take care of his needs. Several days later, Felix came with his wife Drusilla, who was a Jewess. He sent for Paul and listened to him as he spoke about faith in Christ Jesus. As Paul discoursed on righteousness, self-control, and the judgment to come, Felix was afraid and said, that's enough for now. You may leave. When I find it convenient, I will send for you. At the same time, he was hoping that Paul would offer him a bribe, so he sent for him frequently and talked with him. You've got a man sitting in front of Paul who really has been aptly described by Clarence Edward McCartney as one having the power of a king, yet the mind of a slave, enslaved to his passions and yet given such power. He had already come through three disastrous marriages. The first one was with the granddaughter of Antony and Cleopatra, and now Drusilla, who was formerly the mistress of Agrippa. Felix, through a sorcerer's incantations, had lured her away into this relationship. She's still in her teens. And so the man was a conniving, scheming, manipulative individual. And McCartney puts it in these words. What a contrast. On the throne sat Felix, the faded and withered pagan. A former slave, he became a favorite of Claudius, and by that emperor was exalted to high rank. Greed, cruelty, and lust were stamped upon his countenance. His administration as procurator of Judea had been marked by injustice, extortion, and violence. By his side sat the lovely Jewess Drusilla, a daughter of Herod Agrippa. She had first married a Gentile who, to please her, had become a Jew. Then Felix, with the aid of a sorcerer's incantations, had won her from her husband and was living with her in sin and shame. All that was dishonorable in mankind was represented by that combination of Felix and Drusilla as they sat on the throne awaiting the address by St. Paul. Before them, with chains on his arms and his body scarred with the marks of his sufferings for Christ's sake, and his coarse garment which his own hands had woven, contrasting with the velvet and purple of Felix and his paramour, stood the lonely ambassador for Christ. Every time I've read that paragraph, a picture comes to my mind when Mother Teresa was to speak at the presidential prayer breakfast some years ago. She was so diminutive, so tiny. I remember the first time I met her, I was shocked with how little she really was. She would stand there as this tiny little woman clad in her white sari with that blue border, cotton woven sari. And she was so small that she had to be propped up by a box under her feet so that she could be seen by this audience. And there on the platform sat the president and his wife and the vice president and his wife and all of these ambassadors and leaders from all over the world. And this woman bent over like that, pleading for the right of the unborn to have a chance to live. It was such a contrast, such a powerful talk from a life beautifully lived and that had exemplified what she was talking about. And so here stands Paul, probably not very big in stature and supposedly with his eyes that were not very strong in their vision, chains in his arms and recognizing that his destiny was going to take him possibly into martyrdom. In front of Felix, he's presenting his defense. Now, ladies and gentlemen, what I want to talk to you about in this unfolding message, how did Paul make connection with a man like this? What is it that gave him the content so that they wanted to hear what it is he had to say? Very difficult in our time, not just to be given the opportunity to speak, But to be given that kind of respect where your audience is sitting at the edge of their seats waiting to hear what your argument really is. This is not mere oratorical skill. This is combining both theological integrity with methodological genius. It's bringing together theological integrity with methodological genius. He knows how to bring these two together so that both the content and the means through which he's communicating it are retaining their integrity in the process. Very critical to understand that. Hard to do it sometimes. I find myself in situations many times when a question is being raised, the temptation to compromise on the content. How are you going to get past this question? How are you going to answer this? And I want to point out to you the three points through which he was able to pierce the heart of the listener in the best possible way. The first is that he found a point of reference. He found a point of reference so that you would get the listener to listen to you. He appealed to Felix on the issue of righteousness. Now, I suggest to you, Felix probably did not really want to hear about righteousness. So it was an issue on which Paul had to navigate very carefully to get him to realize what righteousness was all about. Because when you and I hear it, we think of it in terms of all that stands over against us, that demands of us, that makes us feel smaller and smaller all the time, not realizing that there's something beautiful and attractive about it, which when rightly understood, you say to yourself, that's what I really want. Is there a way? When you go back across history and you see the arguments that people have used for the establishment of truth, it is fascinating to watch how the pendulum swings from one end to the other. If you go back to the mid-1600s, when rationalism was holding its sway over people through the writings of Descartes, René Descartes, the mathematician philosopher, calling for clear and indubitable certainty in all of the precepts that we could hold to, which then moved him ultimately to the only point from which he felt he could legitimately begin, and that was doubting. And the fact that he doubted established to him, therefore, that he existed. Interesting. From a point of view of skepticism, he was wanting to move to that which was certain, and the only starting point of which he could be certain was that he existed. The fact of the matter is, one cannot really deny one's existence without affirming it at the same time. I remember at the University of Florida, packed audience, a student walked up to the microphone. We have him on video. And he walks up and he lumbers over there and he leans forward and he said, I just have one question. How do I know that I exist? Now you wonder about somebody like that. You wonder if they pay their fees. You wonder if they read their grades. You wonder if they have a driver's license. You know, there's a very simple response to a question like that. And so rather than making it long, I said, may I quote Professor Nathan from the University of New York, who was asked a similar question in his class. And he just lowered his glasses and said, and who, shall I say, is asking? But there be such people in the world who wonder whether you can actually demonstrate for them that they exist. And so Descartes was looking for certainty, and Descartes, if he was actually very precise, he should not have said, I think, therefore I exist. He really should have said, I think, therefore thinking exists. Because how do you move from the capacity to think to the I, which is something much larger that pulls it all together, that at least claims some kind of semi-transcendence over the object of your thought? Therefore, rationalism had its day, and people in many, many ways till this very day will want to only look at some mathematical tautologies as the only thing of which you can be certain. But then comes along somebody like David Hume in the 1700s, the Scottish skeptic, and his point was you can verify, you can test, and the empirical world was the only world of which you could absolutely be certain. That is making its resurgence today in the form of scientism writ large, in the philosophical methods of people like Dawkins and Hitchens and all of them, that science is the real game in town, it's the only game in town. There is no other game in town. This is indeed the greatest show on earth. And science sort of humiliates any idea of religion and ultimately takes its digs at metaphysics itself. So the scientific lab becomes the only place of certainty for some people. I remember when I finished a series of lectures at Cornell, a young woman came up to me and she was literally with tears in her eyes. She said, "Do you know what you're asking me to do in your talks? You're asking me to think in categories that I'm not used to thinking at all. I'm a science major. I deal with the material world, matter." I said, "How do you make your ethical choices? Do you do that from the scientific world? Does science give you an ought from what is?" And she was just wiping the tears away, knowing the paradigm shift was drastic. So from the 1600s of rationalism writ large to the 1700s and 1800s of empiricism, then you come to the time of Immanuel Kant, who tried to bring some kind of a marriage between what you can know and what you can't know, that you can't really posit ultimate reality. You can only talk about the phenomenal world, you can't talk about the noumenal world, and you gradually marginalize any faith in the transcendent. And so once Wittgenstein came on the scene to make any meaningful statements about the existence of God, only became the occupation of escapists, not realists. Is that not where we are today? Take a look at the hit a genius in his field like Francis Collins has taken, only because he is also a believer in God. Here is one of the brightest minds of our time, the scientist, head of the NIH, the co-mapper of the human DNA and the Human Genome Project. One writer recently commenting on his faith in God, you know, even made the comment that some people are wondering whether it is demonstrating early signs of dementia. You know, what does that say about 80% of a billion people in India, some of the brightest minds in the world, who do not believe only in the material world? And you go to other parts of the globe, I'm not saying all that is believed is true, but there is something to be said about the intuitive longing that says to you, matter is not all that there is. And so you move through these ideas. So once upon a time, philosophers would talk of causality, but the argument supposedly by Hume was buried. I don't believe it was at all, but it is supposedly done away with on his idea of the miracles and ultimate cause rather than efficient cause and so on. And then you came through to the argument of design, what you called a teleological argument, purpose-driven argument, where it was not just causality, but specified complexity, intelligibility. And then you got counter-arguments that will take away any sting in that implication. So cosmological argument goes by the wayside today. Nobody even wants to deal with it in a public arena. The teleological argument is done away with because anything would end up looking like design. But I want to suggest to you, there is one argument that still haunts. It haunts and haunts and haunts, and you cannot escape the long arm of that argument. That is the argument of why we think in moral categories. That is the point I want to drive home in Paul's initial approach. He knew Greek philosophy. He sat at the feet of Gamaliel, who was a Hebrew. He understood Roman law and the power of all that Rome wanted to manifest in its nobility and its desire at domination. He knew all of these things. He understood the pagan longing for the divine. And so he addresses even the idea of the unknown God in one of his addresses. I want to say to you this, tell me honestly, how do you get away from explaining the moral argument if matter is all that there ultimately is? You know, when I see questions asked in the public arena, sooner or later we get back to what the moral framework is all about. And may I suggest to you, books like The Da Vinci Code and The Last Temptation of Christ and all of these have a hidden agenda. They knocked off the cosmological argument. They knocked off the teleological argument. They think now if they can make Jesus Christ look like you and me, sensually driven, then we've knocked off the moral argument away as well. Why would a world that has enough to attack in moral behaviorism in Islam, if you watch the life of Muhammad and some of his practices, if Jesus had practiced the same things that he did, I can assure you we'd be on the front pages of every newspaper here mocking the practice. But intellectual cowardice keeps them from tackling the other. Why does one not go and look at even the exploits of some of the pantheistic gods and the 330 million deities in the pantheon of Hinduism? There's enough in there to really make some pretty lurid descriptions of all that went on. Why do they go to the Christ and somehow find out something that they think they want to establish? You know, I'm convinced if Mary Magdalene were everywhere she's supposed to have been on the basis of all the writings of recent times, she would have had to be superhuman herself. First they tell you they found his footsteps in Tibet. Then they tell you he ended up in France. Then Dawkins comes along and wonders if he even existed. What kind of intellectual game playing is this? Because the purity that stands over against us, a la Sam Harris, who talks about it in his book, you know, A Letter to a Christian Nation and the End of Faith. I responded to his book in mine called The End of Reason. Sam Harris blames the Christian world and our archaic view of sexuality and all as being the main reason for guilt-laden feelings in people's lives by putting all the restrictions that we do upon ourselves. But the moral argument stands very strong, very, very strong.